Good afternoon, and welcome to the Your Town television program on AMP's Access Monterey Peninsula Cable Channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Every weekday at 5 o'clock, we are proud to have as our guests various local civic and community leaders. The purpose of the program is to help inform listeners and viewers like you about some of the things going on in your town. And now, on with the program.
Good evening. Welcome to Your Town Television Program. I'm John Sanders, Special Collections Manager at the Naval Postgraduate School's Dudley Knox Library, and your host for tonight's program. My guest tonight is one of the nation's most renowned and revered military analysts and educators. Captain Wayne Hughes, U.S. Navy retired, is also Dean Emeritus of the Naval Postgraduate School's Graduate School of Operations and Information Sciences. He is a fellow and past president of the Military Operations Research Society, and he holds the Society's highest award for distinguished service. He was commanding officer of a minesweeper, destroyer, and large training command. He served in prominent Pentagon positions, and he established the Tactical Analysis Program at the Naval Postgraduate School. Captain Hughes is also an award-winning author. Wayne, it's great to have you on the Your Town program.
Thank you.
I want to start tonight's interview with a discussion of missile warfare at sea. Your Navy career began in the early 1950s when missiles and rockets were emerging as a serious national security and naval threats. So as a young officer, what new technologies did you have to master in this emerging age of missile warfare at sea?
You start off with a bang. I was out there in destroyers going over and doing old-fashioned shooting into the Korean coast in those days, and I gotta say that I didn't know a lot about what was going on until later. But I can tell you what was going on, which was that we had to figure out how to keep our strategic deterrent. And so in those days, the 50s, the CNO, Admiral Burke, started a Polaris submarine program. And so the Navy's role shifted from afloat aircraft carrier delivery of those kinds of weapons to missiles delivering them from under the water. Simultaneously, there was a lot of thinking going on in this country and others about what we could do with missiles that didn't have nuclear warheads. And in the late 60s, after the successful attack by the Egyptians on an Israeli destroyer, the Eilat, all of a sudden people started to become aware that missiles were going to become the dominant weapon for surface-to-surface engagements. The Israelis, for example, immediately commissioned the building of SAR boats, which had a 12-mile missile, and the Egyptians developed, bought from the Soviet Union, missile ships that had a capability that outranged the Israelis, and there was a very interesting tactical development for the Israelis on how they were going to defeat a missile that outranged them, and they succeeded in doing that through clever development of soft kill, by which I mean jamming, decoys, chaff, and that sort of thing.
So the issue of extended range capability was really changing the tactical nature of certainly surface warfare, as well as the strike capability that Polaris provided for submarines.
The submarines got in the act because of nuclear missiles, and also eventually they were able to fire non-nuclear missiles that came out of the tubes, burst into the air, and became Tomahawks and harpoon missiles. But the significance of all this was that we, during the carrier era, which lasted from, let's say, 1940 to the end of the 1960s, you had to have a ship in World War II. It was 20,000 tons. By this time, the ships had become 80,000 tons. They carried 70 or 80 aircraft, whether they were 20,000 tons or 80,000 tons, because the aircraft were getting bigger and faster. As soon as we went to missiles, we, the world's fleets, then we could put those missiles in a ship that was 1% the size of an aircraft carrier, put six or eight of them on board, and all of a sudden we could distribute our capability, our offensive capability, much more effectively than just firing from, delivering our stuff from aircraft.
And when you talk about the significance, this is something you've been able to put together, as understand in your career in hindsight. You didn't see it that way at the time, did you?
Didn't have a clue. I was out there as an innocent, steaming around in the ocean, in the mine force, again in destroyers, and this was what we did. We went out and we refueled at sea, we rearmed at sea, but we were rearming with our guns, not with missiles. This all started to emerge after I came to the Naval Postgraduate School, and then went to nuclear power school, and then went to another tour at sea, but pretty soon went to the Pentagon, and the scales fell off my eyes.
Yeah, so let's kind of jump forward to a somewhat contemporary period, and possibly an analogous evolution that is taking place in this case, robotics. About 10 years ago, you were about to be interviewed by the History Channel for a documentary, and you and I were talking before the interview began, and you commented about the emergence of the age of robotics. Unmanned systems, as we see them today, are an important part of operational forces. In your view, we could talk about, I'm sure, unmanned systems and robotics for a full hour, as some other professors have mentioned to me, but what is your view on the use of autonomous systems in today's military, and what do you think we might see in the years ahead?
They're here. In the air, they're here. The people are reading about attacks and reconnaissance missions, and they have a great role potentially in saving lives. I go back to World War II and think about the aircraft we lost in World War II, and this is a chance to see, and seeing as part of shooting, and shoot without having to have a man pilot there all the time. The most urgent thing today is probably to figure out how to coordinate a manned aircraft's role and an unmanned aircraft's role, I think that's coming. But I also am very proud of the fact that the PG school is right in the middle of that with a program called Cruiser, which is developing not only the easy ones, which is aerial unmanned vehicles and aerial robotic vehicles that will pretty soon be able to swarm and cooperate to counter enemy programs that are developing swarming and cooperating attackers. The hard ones are underwater and on the surface of the water and on the ground.
The Cruiser program, operations research faculty are involved in that particular research project. Your disciplinary background is in operations research. There are others from the university who were actively involved, because it cuts across several departments and disciplines, doesn't it?
The really great thing, the reason the undersecretary and the secretary chartered us to do this with money, was because it was so interdisciplinary, cross departments, cross disciplines, cross cultural, and we've got people from every department, and even more important, we have 300 or maybe 400 participants, including many people that are not on campus.
Interdisciplinary, when you and colleagues talk about interdisciplinary programs, there are always certain challenges, aren't there, Wayne, with being able to go beyond the parameters of your own disciplinary grounding and collaborate, let's say, operations research professor with an electrical and computer engineer with an aviations engineer?
Nobody can do it all, but I will point out that some people do more than one thing. The technical advisor in the cruiser program is a young professor named Tim Chung. He got his undergraduate degree in mechanical engineering at Caltech, and then he went on to get his PhD in search theory, which was very much an operations research thing. And he came here, and we hired him in the OR department, and I think he burst the seams. So he's now in the systems engineering department, which may be a better place for him. But more important, he's found a home in the cruiser program. And he's one of the ones who is doing exciting things like taking small experimental unmanned aerial vehicles, robotic aerial vehicles, and he's going to have a fly-off in which it's sort of like capture the flag. There are two sides. These are real things. These are flying things, and the people program them to do what they want to, and the idea is to hit the enemy's target is flag, and both sides are trying to do that in real time simultaneously, and they also have defensive mechanisms like I'm not quite sure how it works, but you crash into the other guy's robot and just do that, and it doesn't cost a lot of money because these are experimental, and the coming robots that are going to be doing this for real are also relatively inexpensive, and we want to build them so that they are relatively inexpensive.
Do you see any unintended consequences from the development of autonomous systems?
There's a whole world of people who are very nervous. Ethicists have been saying that it's unfair, it's unethical, it's improper to send an unmanned vehicle, this is not a robotic vehicle, but an unmanned vehicle that is being controlled from, say, Kansas City, and have it go out and hit a target and kill somebody. When you get to the robotic era, we have to be very careful in how we program these things, but if we do it right, I think there's a chance that robots will actually save lives, because a pilot has to go in and make an instant decision whether this is an enemy combatant or an innocent family that he's attacking. But a robot can circle two or three times, and if it's an enemy combatant and he gets shot down, nobody gets hurt. I think that there are good things and bad things, but it really doesn't matter because the genie is out of the bottle and robots are here, and we just better develop them as ethically but as potently as we can.
Wayne, I'd like to turn to some of today's issues. Yesterday's newspapers, in fact, ran page one stories about President Obama's guidance to Secretary of Defense Leon Panetta for deep cuts in the defense budget. The stories highlighted the Secretary's plan to shape a smaller, faster, more agile force. What methods would you use to assess the impact of budget cuts, along with the development of a smaller, faster, more agile force for strategy, military capabilities, and to promote national security?
It's really a blend of experience, and we're fortunate to have a Secretary of Defense with lots of experience in defense, in intelligence matters, which are becoming more and more important as we go along, and in budgetary things, so he's the right guy at the top. And at every level, the services, let's take the Navy. The Navy is going to have to reconsider where it's going to spend its money, and probably we need to be talking about a more distributable Navy that exploits missiles, exploits cyber operations, exploits unmanned vehicles. And in order to understand for ourselves and to explain to the Secretary of Defense's office and explain to the Office of Money Management and Budget and explain to the congressmen and their staffs, then that takes a lot of systems engineering and systems analysis, the kind of thing that my old office, N81, is very good at, and as well as the Navy's strategists who developed our combat strategy 21 for the 21st century. The strategy is there, but I haven't seen much impact yet on Navy substance. So we have a springboard, and we just have to get on with it and recognize that if we're going to be able to continue to work as we have, we'll have to do that.
So priorities, budget priorities in the Pentagon today, what would your recommendations be for top priorities?
I'm not sure I can answer that because we have bases which are expensive, we have personnel which are expensive, we have present operations which are going to shift away from the Middle East and more towards the Western Pacific, and we have the need to get on with programmatic choices. My expertise is in tactics as they affect the future shape of the Navy and a little bit the other services, as probably will emerge later.
So in terms of emphasis on tactical skill and tactical ability to respond in an emergency, what would you need? What kind of military capability would you need to have effective tactical plans to respond in an emergency?
I'm going to give you a surprise answer. We have China, of course, and that's the big elephant that we need to be concerned about, but there are all kinds of situations around the world, and this nimbleness that I espouse and the Navy has been good at means that we have to be able to do things like humanitarian relief. And we've done that quite successfully, and we probably could be even more successful. You don't need a huge ship. You need many ships that can get there quickly and do the things that have to be done.
Great. Wayne, we're going to take just a very short break. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Your Town and continue the interview with Captain Wayne Hughes.
Just a moment with more of the Your Town television program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org.
Welcome back to Your Town television program. I'm John Sanders, your host for tonight's program, and I'm Special Collections Manager at the Naval Postgraduate School's Dudley Knox Library. Our host is Navy expert and author, Captain Wayne Hughes, also Dean Emeritus of the Naval Postgraduate School, School of Operations and Information Sciences. Wayne, I want to move now to a brief discussion about the Pentagon, because you had some important tours at the Pentagon One of those tours was under Admiral Elmo Zumwalt, who was the Navy's youngest four-star admiral. He was 49 years old when he was promoted to four-star. When he retired as Chief of Naval Operations, you were working for him, and you wrote a short note to him. He sent a response back. He said, "It's guys like you that generate my steam." And it, you know, has this, the note has this, you know, real personal appeal to it. It's genuine. What was it like to be an analyst during Admiral Zumwalt's tenure as Chief of Naval Operations?
Probably as satisfying as anything one could hope for. When I was an analyst working directly for him when he was a rear admiral, I thought we were saving the Navy from itself. This was hogwash, but I believed in quantitative methods. I believed in analytic rigor. I believed in numbers. I believed in objectivity. And there was a time when we all went in when the organization was lean and mean, and we said, how much do you want us to take account of what the Congress is thinking, what the Secretary of Defense is thinking, even what the CNO is thinking? And he said, give me your best objective opinion, and I'll put the spin on it. And that's the sort of thing he was. He was, when he got to be CNO, he was very controversial because he had to do some things with the Navy to drag it into the 20th century from the 19th century, in my opinion. And I've always thought that if he could have touched everybody that he was trying to influence, he would have been as charmed as I was by his charismatic leadership, by his personal devotion. But one of the reasons that he was doing things that were unpopular was because he did them from on high, and he'd been promoted over a lot of more senior admirals. Those were tough years, but he succeeded beyond measure in because he believed in both objective advice and in doing the hard things that had to be done. For example, he came to CNO from being working in Vietnam, where he also did some hard things and some hard fighting and put lives at risk over there when he was working for the Army commander. I also remember Admiral Holloway, who replaced him, and Admiral Holloway was in his own way just as valuable because he had to restabilize us. The China was broken. Now he had to, it'd be a mixed metaphor, but if you think of putting Humpty Dumpty back together again, that's sort of the idea. And Admiral Holloway was cool too, and we got to see a lot of him as well because we were trusted. And if you ever lose your reputation for objectivity, you're dead. As an analyst, your boss depends upon you not to tell him what you think or what you think he thinks, but to give him your best shot at objectivity. A lot of those things can't say at all. You can't. Quantitative analysis can only carry you so far, and we know that, and he knows that, and if you have that connection, then wonderful things happen.
This is such an important perspective on the operations research as a discipline and the utilization of that disciplinary skill within a particular service or an organization, in this case, the Navy. The objectivity and the rigor that you mentioned really do have to be paramount, don't they?
Got to. Admiral Zumwalt, when he was my boss as a rear admiral, was bitterly opposed to what he thought was some bad decision making in ASW planning. And the arguments were supported by a contractor, and he used the word prostitution in referring to the work that they were doing for this other agency.
Now, how would you compare your Pentagon assignment to earlier duties that you had as commanding officer of first a minesweeper and then later a destroyer?
Well, the minesweeper command was what kept me in the Navy. Two things. One, I had a boss in my first destroyer who was a Rhodes Scholar who taught me there was more of the Navy than being an officer of the deck, and there was intellectual challenges there. And then when I got to be commanding officer as a lieutenant, responsible for 30 lives and a couple of million dollars worth of ship, they were cheap then, I was not going to leave the Navy until I got my destroyer command. I learned ship handling so that I could do it in my sleep. So when I had my destroyer command, everybody on that ship, we did lots of sailing, and everybody on the ship got to get up on the bridge and handle the ship until it was in extremis, because I knew when it was time, but I'd let them find out for themselves if I possibly could. I remember I've talked about the greats that I've worked for, and I'm not going to mention any names of the not so greats, but we had a division commander who we other ship captains referred to as Shaky Jake, because he was not qualified for that job. He knew he was not qualified for it, and he was therefore uptight and made our lives more difficult.
That early command experience, you've told me on previous conversations, in fact, the very first conversation I think you and I had at the Naval Postgraduate School, it was an early interview, and you really highlighted that experience on board the USS Hummingbird as a young lieutenant and in command. It had an influence throughout your career. Could you talk a little bit more about that influence?
You know, my friend Jeff Klein had a much hotter small ship. It was a PHM, and they went 40 knots on hydrofoils, and mine had a maximum speed of 14. But both of us felt that it changed our lives, because it gave us a sense of what was important, what was right. And I can remember later, when I was in my second destroyer, and later still, when the other officer, I was still a lieutenant when I was ops officer later on of another destroyer, thinking that the other officers in the wardroom didn't have a clue what the responsibility of command was like, and I did, and they would worry about things that I thought were frivolous, and they would not worry about things that I thought were something that the captain had to take care of.
You have obviously the ship, the equipment, the ability to maneuver, engage, execute a mission. You also have the crew, and the crew can be a complex mix of human relations and dynamic psychological interaction, I would assume.
I still like to look back at my cruise books and remember the personalities of some of the people. It taught me then, and I still believe 10-80-10 is a pretty good metaphor for people in every profession and every level of profession. 10%, it's more like 15 actually, but 10-80-10 has a ring about it. A handful of people are the lions who you would do anything for, because they're the people who make things work. There's 10% at the bottom who I think of as jackals, who are so bad that all you can do is try and neutralize them so they won't poison the apple barrel. And then the 80% in the middle, the job is to let the lions lead them and get the round pegs in the round holes and the square pegs in the square holes.
What a great, great perspective. Wayne, did you learn any lessons during that time that you might characterize as universal truths for the surface Navy? no matter what the time, the technology, the methodology, is there anything that kind of carries through generation after generation?
No, the only way I've thought about that was when I was thinking about tactics, and I, you're kind of talking about principles.
Yes.
Yeah. And my conclusion about principles was you figure out what they are, and then they just lie there. And I'm more interested in processes. And processes are a dynamic thing. They change or they don't change over time. So in the tactical realm, I can speak at greater length than we have time for on trends, which are things that have changed, such as the greater range of weapons and the greater range of the scouting that must go with it to tell the weapons where to shoot. And there are constants, and you're asking me what the constants of leadership are, and I know what they are insofar as winning battles are concerned, but the life and role of a commanding officer or any leader is so much greater than that, that I'm going to stop there.
Okay. In the 1980s, Wayne, you wrote really the definitive book on Cold War naval tactics, fleet tactics, theory, and practice. I have a copy with a little bit tattered cover. But what inspired you to write this particular book at that stage in your career?
I started thinking about it soon after I got to the Naval Academy, to the Naval Postgraduate School. I'd been at the Naval Academy and taught naval history, and that got my juices flowing. And when I had this chance at the Naval Postgraduate School in 79, within a year or two, I was looking at what was the tactics of the day. Where were the foundational things that everybody needed to know about modern naval tactics? And you could find them in spades through the Age of Fighting Sail, through the battleship era, through and up to the aircraft carrier era, and then there was a big vacuum. There was no American book on fleet tactics or any other kind of tactics written by an American for over 50 years. One Italian, a fellow named Fioravanzo, had written a very fine book, but it sort of petered out as he got into World War II. And so I called my friend Hugh Knott, captain retired at the Naval War College, and I asked him, do you know of any book? And he said, no, come to think of it, I'll go look in the library. And so we agreed that such a book needed to be written and that we would write it. And the original plan was for him to pick up after World War II and for me to write up to World War II. And then we got a contract signed with the Naval Institute to write it. And then there was a pause while he finished writing a novel he was writing about the sea. And I had some things on my plate, too. And sad to say, Hugh died. And I was stuck with now figuring out what the modern tactics would be and what the shift would be. And it probably is a better book because one man wrote it, but that's how the book came about.
Is there a need for a new tactics book in this century?
Well, I wrote the first book to be timeless. That was 1986. It was published in 1986. It was written in 84, 85. And when the Soviet Union collapsed, a friend of mine, again at the War College, said, Wayne, your book's overtaken by events. What are you going to do about that? And I said, yeah, I guess you're right. So I reoriented it and issued a second edition, but changed the name. So the new book emphasizes coastal combat, and that's when we, and I, it also allowed me to, since the first book was a success, it allowed me to put more equations into the second book. Not very many, but enough to make some points about modern warfare and salvo warfare.
So I'll just show this book. This is Fleet Tactics. Is this
the revised edition?
The revised edition.
Came out in 1999.
Okay, Fleet Tactics and Coastal Combat. You've been at the Naval Postgraduate School as a military professor, as a civilian professor, as a dean of one of the graduate schools. You've worked with a number of students over the years. Naval Postgraduate School requires a master's thesis for the thesis project for the degree. A lot of universities have dropped this requirement. In your opinion, is the thesis important?
One of the most valuable things that we do, because it makes them do some research and writing. And we have 1.5 to 2 years to graduate them with their master's degree. You can think of it as 1 year of master's degree education, maybe 6 months to get them up to speed, because some of these people haven't been in school for a very long time, some prominent people that have gone through the school, and then another 6 months at the end to write their thesis and to get Navy-specific courses like the one that I've taught for many years, campaign analysis.
You've mentored a number of students who've had exceptional military careers, among them Admiral Mike Mullen, the recently retired chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Vice Admiral Patricia Tracy, who's the highest ranking woman in U.S. Navy history. What are your views on the relationship between an NPS student and a thesis advisor? And what do you see as key attributes of a successful advisor?
I'm going to start with my own thesis advisor. When I was a student, it was Peyton Cunningham, who was one of the greats of the Naval Postgraduate School and one of the founding faculty members of the Operations Research Program. He left me alone. He let me do my he gave me hints. But the freedom to prosecute my own thinking was the most valuable thing he did for me. So it was always my intent, if the officer like Pat Tracy had the get up and go and didn't come whining to you asking for what do I do now. Pat Tracy was my very first thesis student. She rose to be a vice admiral, a senior vice admiral in the Navy, and she was the highest ranking woman naval officer ever to serve. And she had an idea, and I said, that's splendid. She taught me as much about the idea, the concept as I taught her. And in Mike Mullen's case, he also was a self-starter, and he had actually gathered a lot of information for his thesis. And he came to me because it was about the Navy. It was against the Soviet Union, so it's sort of obsolete now, but it was very tactically oriented, and I was tactically oriented. So that was a very happy marriage as well. I can think of Rear Admiral Sinclair Harris, who is an African-American, very influential right now, working in irregular warfare. He was my thesis student, and the thesis he wrote had nothing to do with irregular warfare, but it taught him to think.
And that's the purpose of the thesis.
Yeah.
Wayne, we're going to take another short break. Stay with us. We'll be back in just a moment to continue the interview with Captain Wayne Hughes.
We'll be back in just a moment with more of the Your Town television program here on AMP's Cable Channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org.
Welcome back to Your Town television program. I'm John Sanders, Special Collections Manager at the Naval Postgraduate School's Dudley Knox Library. Our guest tonight, Captain Wayne Hughes, Dean Emeritus of the Graduate School of Information and Operations Sciences at the Naval Postgraduate School. And Wayne, during the short break, we were talking a little bit about the earlier parts of the interview, and you mentioned an experience that you had at the Pentagon in which your wife, Joan, offered her perspective to you on jobs, the life at the Pentagon.
There is the family side, and we got to say something about that. When I came home at 10 or 11, the first thing she said was, "What were you working on today?" And I'd talk about something that was not going to be relevant for 5 or 10 years. And she said, "Why are you working so late for something that is that far in the future?" She said she saw more of me when I was aboard ship, sometimes going off on cruises of several months' duration, than she did when I was in Washington working in the Pentagon. I was fortunate to have a good Navy wife, somebody who was always ready to go, pick up and go, and we lived in 22 houses in the 27 years of marriage. And I will say that when we came out here, we said to each other, we're going to move once into our retirement home, and that's it, and that's what we've done.
Joan is a very inspiring woman, and you mentioned in one of your notes to me that it was she who really gave your daughters their strength of character.
I think that the good thing about a Navy life and the absence of a father, but still a parent who was very much in the family, and a heavy burden. Joan did many auto repairs and replaced the appliances and brought those children up to be self-reliant and inquisitive and eager for adventure.
Wayne, during your career, you've also served as president of the Military Operations Research Society. And in one of the publications during your presidency, you wrote, "We are in a profession that is fuzzy around the edges." you also went on to note that you had recently asked your students at the Naval Postgraduate School who were in their final quarter of study what they thought their responsibilities were in formulating, pursuing, and delivering a study. It gets right to the core of rigor and objectivity in operations research. You noted that there was an initial stunned silence, but that was followed by a furious discussion. So how did this discussion unfold, and what were the students' conclusions once they got over their stunned reaction to your question?
I think the fuzziness around the edges says it all. We use quantitative methods. That means we get specific mathematical answers. Sometimes they are a spread of a statistical and stuff like that. But they're numbers. And the danger with numbers is in our business, because there are things that you can't capture in a sea battle, in a campaign, in a budget decision. This is telling people as much as they can, as I can, as an analyst, that will help them make the right decision. The fuzziness comes because there are always things that will affect the decision, whether it's a battle or whether it's a budget, that can't be captured by quantitative analysis. If I get that through to the students, a willingness to think quantitatively, to use the powerful tools that we have, and they are getting very powerful now. There's so much more that you can do with modern computer spreadsheets and other forms of optimization techniques than in the early days when I was teaching, and much, much more than when I was a student back in the 60s. All of those things are very powerful, and we just have to be careful that we don't let the magic of building the model convince us that we have now describe the problem in its all its aspects. Mm-hmm. You don't want to be over enchanted with your model. Right.
Dick Hamming would say the purpose of computing is insight, not numbers.
Yeah.
And what a great computer scientist he was.
Yeah.
What have you gained most from your work and contributions to the Military Operations Research Society?
I think it was finding out how many smart people there are in the Army community, in the Air Force community. I think of Clay Thomas as a foundational guy in Air Force analysis, trusted by all the people he advised up to and including generals. I think of E.B. Vandiver and many others in the Army that I got to know and work with. And I learned a little bit about how they do their analysis, and there are differences, and there should be, because their problems are different. But I learned a lot about the people and their devotion and their intention to conduct analysis as I've been describing it.
And working with colleagues within operations research in the broader community, at the Naval Postgraduate School, worldwide, what have you found and what have you gained from these interactions with colleagues?
Well, as an aside, I want to tell you that the biggest reward, the biggest payoff is working with students. But the fellowship and the pleasure I've had with people like Al Washburn and now retired Mike Sovereign and Bob Reed and Rex Schutte and Jack Borsting back to those who are still with us, Jerry Brown, Rob Dell, our chairman, Jim Eagle, our past chairman, all of these people are just a pleasure to work with. Not every academic is a pleasure to work with, but right. But we have an extraordinary department.
Now, how many of those colleagues do you play poker with, and how many of you won money from?
they're very good at the poker table, and I've ticked off several who have a. We play a game that you can't predict, because we can all know the odds, so we make sure that the poker games we play are weird enough that you have to, you can't just do the computation and play the odds.
You received a Defense Technology Fellowship from the Republic of Singapore. What was your relationship with Singapore, and how did it develop?
It was an odd thing that I went there. But I won't go into how it happened that I went. I went thinking that I was going to be an advisor for 6 months on their developing an operations analysis capability, inspired by PC Louie, who was a graduate of the PG school and at that time the chief defense scientist and very influential in everything that goes on in Singapore, in my judgment. I also did a lot of teaching, and the teaching was a surprise, and we had a lot of discussions about what I should cover. It was sort of playing it from the hip, but we assembled notes on a lot of different things, and the students were very smart, and they now are middle to upper level managers in either systems analysis or in engineering analysis in Singapore. That was so successful that they invited me back several times.
Wayne, you have some personal philosophies. You've posted one maxim on your refrigerator that you've attributed to Abraham Lincoln. It reads, "Whatever you are, be a good one." Now, what's your interpretation of this maxim?
I wrote that in the context that if you live your life always looking at the guy with more money than you have, or an easier job than you have, or you think the grass would be greener on the other side of the fence, That's a way to make your life miserable. As long as you are content with that you are doing the best you can to do the best job you can, not the best job anybody can, but the best job you can, then you're in the right place. When you get burned out, then maybe you should look around and think about something else.
You also shared with me a belief that one of the most important things in life is to find two people, at least two, who are smarter than you and to nurture their careers. And you said, I can claim more than two, although it took a while. Now, would you care to elaborate on this?
In Fleet Tactics, you'll find, I thought it was the most daring thing I wrote, that in peacetime, the most important thing a commanding officer can do is find two officers who are better than he is and nurture their careers. And when I came here, and I'd been here for 10 years, it occurred to me that the same thing was true here. And so I count Jeff Klein as an example of somebody I had mentored. And I mentioned Tim Chung. He might not be here if I hadn't help put this round peg in this rut, and there are several others that I feel I can't claim they're here because of me, but I certainly did everything I could to make them more valuable as professors and teachers.
Well, certainly as the dean of the graduate school, you had a really key role in recruiting and retention of faculty, as well as guiding and steering program development. There has to be a certain sense of accomplishment that you have a legacy at NPS that will endure for some time.
I can retire again with a feeling that I've done as much as the average guy can do, but I have a slightly different perspective on my deanship. I took the job with utmost reluctance because I didn't want to be an administrator. I wanted to teach, and it was supposed to last 6 months, and it lasted 4.5 years. And the reason it was so easy and satisfying were not the things you were talking about, but the fact that my chairmen were so good, the ones that I didn't pick. I simply, well, that's not quite true, but basically the chairmen were so much qualified, talented, self-starters, and they always pushed back. If I had some cockamamie idea, and the freedom of deanship is, if you've got that kind of people working for you, you can try out cockamamie ideas, and then they'll come and tell you, we tried that 10 years ago and it didn't work. Or don't do that because, and then I can back off. So we had a highly successful growing department with lots and lots of new students coming all the time.
We have a couple of minutes left, not much time. You had emphasized earlier in the interview how important students were in the equation for your work here at the postgraduate school. Tell me a little bit more about that relationship that you had with students over the years.
And I would not be here to age 80, still working at the Naval Postgraduate School, if it wasn't for the students. They keep you thinking young, they're mature, they are energetic, they are hardworking, they are appreciative of the fact that we're paying for their education. That means we can work them like dogs. And the only problem you need to worry about is if you aren't giving them fair value, you'll hear back from them.
And meaning that they will let you know if you're not working them like a dog?
That's right.
Well, Wayne, It's not often that I get a chance to have an interview with someone that I've worked with for some 20 5 years or so, and so I really appreciate your being here tonight. Do you have any closing comments, whether it's to colleagues who might be tuning in from watching the webcast from around the world, or just colleagues over at the Naval Postgraduate School who have been friends for a while?
This is just a little detail, but it occurred to me something that I wanted to say and failed to, was I talked about the old dogs in the department and across the campus, but the younger generation in my department and pretty much across the campus are a great new fit. They're skillful at distance learning. Distance learning is a coming method of delivery, and so I want to mention the younger generation of faculty as a part in part too.
All right, Wayne, thank you. Thanks for joining us, Captain Wayne Hughes.
Thank you very much for joining us today on the Your Town television program here on AMP's cable channel 24 and on the internet at ampmedia.org. Don't forget, the Your Town television program is on every weekday afternoon at 5 o'clock. For more information about the Your Town television program, go to our website, montereyradio.com. The Your Town television program is produced by Jim and Mary Lou Vossen under montereyradio.com. Thank you very much for joining us today.